It's already 11:25, so I got... Can y'all listen fast?
Yeah.
I have to talk fast, amen? So hang with me for just a few minutes. Have your Bible turn to Colossians chapter 3, verse 15. Colossians 3:15. Amen. How to marry a priest? Be decisive. Right? What's the next one? Be consistent. What's the next one? Be obedient. What's the next one? Be humble. Not humble, but humble. Number five?
Be still.
Be still. Very good. Today we're going to talk about be thankful. Be thankful. Amen. How many are thankful?
Amen.
What are you thankful for? I'm just thankful. Amen. Good to be in the house of the Lord. I'm thankful to be in the house of God. Thankful to have a church, the pastor, and thankful for a lot of stuff in my life. You guys there yet? Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Colossians. Get there. Turn right at John. Amen, you there? Colossians 3:15. Ethan, you there? Let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you're called in one body, and be thankful. Be thankful. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also you're called in one body, and be thankful. Or, take the year. Be thankful. Are you thankful this morning?
Yes.
Are you thankful that God's able to bless you this morning?
Yes.
Are you thankful that God's able to take care of you this morning?
Yes.
I went yesterday to Tulsa with a group of 10 wonderful people, and thank you guys so much for going. And we had a great time, and I was thankful that I got to go with them. And then we had Cody. I don't know how many people went to Fraser City with Cody, and also with Janet Tommy. I don't know how many people went up there. We had about 60 people out here at other places yesterday, and maybe that's why everybody's bragging a little bit. I don't know, but. I'm thankful that we had people to take care of things, and I didn't have to do everything. Amen? But how many know when you don't take care of everything, you don't always get what you expect? Just letting you know that God is doing great things here. Now, this morning I look around and there's empty seats, and I don't like empty seats. Phyllis really isn't that mean. Amen? Cody is, but Phyllis isn't. Alright, so Cody's just hateful. He's not really mean. But just let you know that. You know, it's true. Okay, and so let you know that God wants to have peace in your heart this morning. He wants you to have peace. And so us as Christians are supposed to have peace, right? We're not supposed to be everywhere and going everywhere and doing everything, going crazy, going nuts. And how many know that you're not supposed to be upset all the time over something silly and something stupid? But you're always supposed to be that God is peaceful in your life. You mean you're not ever going to have any trouble? No, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that you know that God is the God of peace. And if I have peace in my life, then I understand that God's going to take care of the situation. I know what's going on. And listen, we have problems in church just like everybody else has problems in church. But I'm confident that God's going to take care of the situation. Amen?
Amen.
I'm confident that God's going to do what He needs to do and do what He has to do and take care of situations so I can have peace in knowing that I have trusted Him, and therefore I'm thankful that God is able to do whatever He needs to do. I'm thankful that God brought you to church this morning and got you here safe. I'm thankful that God allowed me to get up this morning and wipe the sleepies out of my eyes and roll out of bed and get in the shower and get dressed and come to church and everything. I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful that we have a church that's able to send people places and do things, and we have the ability to do that. And I'm thankful for that. Can I share with you just a minute? I don't know if I've preached this enough to you lately, but we are going somewhere. We're doing something. And don't you get discouraged. And don't you get weary in well-doing. And don't you get distracted. And I want leadership. Look at me, leadership. Okay. Don't you dare get distracted and get off the wall. Don't you dare get distracted and start... Well, I knew we weren't going to do nothing anyway. I don't know how y'all think we're building a shotgun shanty somewhere. Amen? And what we're doing, well, I knew we're just like always, we're all going to do this. And listen, shut it up. Zip it up. Lock it up. And if you can't do that, then please resign and don't be the leader. Because I want you to understand something. I want you to understand. I'm not mad at you, but I want you to understand. Get behind what we're doing and start pushing what we're doing. And not criticizing what we're doing, but start pushing what we're doing. And get excited about what we're doing. And do your very best at doing it. Okay? Is that fair? Be thankful. I'm thankful that we have the people and the facilities to do what we're doing now. But I want to do greater and more things. I want us to do greater. Listen, some of us want to be great leaders, but we can't even handle the 8 we have now. Can I get a witness? Some of us have illusions of grandeur, but we can't come to church. And some of us have illusions of grandeur, but we can't pray. Some of us have illusions of grandeur, but we're not thankful for anything. We're always mad about something. And so can I share with you that is not what God has called us to be. He has called us to be thankful and let the peace of God rule. Do what? Let it do what?
Rule.
Let the peace of God rule in your heart. Not the confusion, not the downheartedness, not the whatever you want to call it, the anger, the whatever it is that you want to throw out there and put in that blank. But let the peace of God rule your heart. Rule. Let it be the ruler. The peace of God be the ruler of your heart, to the which also you're called to be one body. Not what your little plan is, but you're called to be part of the body. If the body wants to go that way, then we can't have our arms and legs go one way, or we look like a little freak trying to walk. Okay? And so we don't want our arms and legs to go one direction as we're trying to get this direction. We need to continue to go forward and do what God's called us to do. And so let the peace of God rule your heart. I know people get distracted. I know we get weary. I know we get weary in well-doing. And I know that we think, well, it's never going to happen, never going to happen. But listen, you 10 spies of the land of promise, I'm telling you that the 2 spies are still saying, yes, we can. And yes, we can. Don't you keep us from our promised land because the 10 said, oh, we can't do it. And the 10 overruled the 2.
Amen.
We're going to continue to do it. We're going to continue to do it. Amen. Let the peace of God rule your heart. In which also you're called to be one body and be thankful. What are you thankful for today? Are you thankful that you're saved this morning? Are you thankful that you're not in the hospital this morning? Nursing home this morning? I know that a young man that worked at Walmart, went to school now, was a couple years younger now, George, died yesterday. Was it yesterday?
Friday.
Died just, when was it?
Friday night.
George is 40, 41? I thought I said 42. 41 years old. Good guy. Very sweet man. Gone. Went to work. Didn't he work that day? Worked that day, went home and died. So are you thankful that you're here today and you're not dead? Are you thankful that you're not sick this morning?
Amen.
Somebody said, well, aren't you thankful not unto death? Amen. Aren't you thankful that you're not on dialysis this morning? Aren't you glad that you're not taking chemotherapy this morning? Aren't you glad that you're not having to go through radiation today? Aren't you glad that everything in your body is working like it's supposed to, as far as you know right now? Aren't you glad that you don't have some kind of cancer ravaging your body? Aren't you excited to know? Aren't you thankful that God saw fit to keep you healthy?
Yes.
When hospitals are full, anytime I ever go to the hospital to see somebody, it takes me 15 minutes to park. Because it's so full. And I don't have to walk. You know, and you have to park way out in the South 40, and then you have to walk. Amen? Because the hospitals are so full of people. I've gone to the Chickasaw, whatever that place is, down at Ada. It used to be Carl Albert. I don't remember what it's called now. But you know, go down there. It is completely full. I've been there many times. That parking lot is so full every time I go because there's a bunch of people that are sick, or they think they're sick, or they whatever, and they're going to go see a doctor or whatever. And so they go, and they are just there, and they're in the waiting room for hours. I'm so thankful that I have to do that. I'm thankful that I don't have to go to the emergency room and I don't have to do that stuff. I'm so very thankful for that. I'm thankful this morning that I don't have to worry about whether I pay my water bill or not. Does anybody understand? God's with me this morning. I'm thankful that I have to choose where I'm going to eat today, not if I'm going to eat today. As you can tell, I've not missed many meals in the last few years. Okay? I'm so thankful that I don't have to worry about that stuff. I don't have to worry about whether I can put gas in my car. I don't have to worry about whether if I blow out a tire, whether I can buy a tire or not. Amen?
Amen.
I don't have to worry about my electric being cut off or my gas being cut off. I don't worry about that stuff. It's God's taken care of me greatly and God's blessed me greatly. But it didn't come because I'm so wonderful and because I'm so good looking. It came by doing what God said to do. It came by giving and receiving and letting the peace of God rule in my heart. Do you know it's hard to be a pastor and have the peace of God in your heart all the time? Because y'all drive me nuts. I love you, but you're driving me crazy. Amen? Not all of you. Some bless me, some stress me. Amen? Let me put that scripture back up for me, please. Thank you. It's not always possible to have the joy of the Lord in my heart, the peace of the Lord in my heart all the time. I try to. I try very hard to. But sometimes it's very difficult. It's amazing the things that, you know, God blesses us and blesses us and blesses us and blesses us. And one thing in our life happens and we just can't handle it. It's like, dude, what's wrong with you? You have 900 things that are great and one thing's bad and your whole world is in shambles. And I don't understand it. Maybe I'm not compassionate enough. I don't know. I try to be. But it's just hard to be when I look at your life and I see God bless. And then there's one little area that God's going to take you out of, and I know he's going to take you out of, and it'll become a blessing to you. And then you're just okay. Whatever. How do you get a testimony? You have to do what? Go through a test. Unless you just want to test a lie. A lot of folks get up and test a lie. They prophet lie a lot too. Amen. I got a word, dude. Hallelujah. You can't live, Rob. You got a word. Amen. Okay, I'm sorry. I got off track. Anyway. If you had to turn it over to Romans chapter 1, verse 21. Is that too hard? Is that all right? I was going to say it anyway, so it doesn't matter. Okay. Romans 1, 21. Because that, when they knew God, how many know God?
Amen.
Oh, put your hand up like you know God. I don't know. I was back here during worship service, or not during the song service, and y'all didn't wake up of it, eh? God is sitting there going, clapping on all the heat. You know, I don't know if y'all clapping or y'all just swat fly. And music's like. They knew the Lord, but they didn't glorify him as God. Because the problem became greater than their God. The things that happened in their lives became greater than the thing that should be the number one thing in their life, which is God. And when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were they thankful. I read this week and I thought, I don't want to preach this. But neither were they thankful, but became vain in their imaginations. And we're going to go somewhere in imaginations. What's the root word of imagination? How about image? Became vain in their image, and their foolish heart was darkened. Because of when they knew God, I don't mean to burst your bone, but you can know God and then knew God. Okay. And they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were they thankful. How many of us are truly thankful about what God's done in our lives? Preach, I'm trying. How many are truly thankful for what God's done in your life? How many are you truly thankful that your children are not sick today? You ever see the commercials for like St. Jude's and all that? Goodness, these little bitty babies have cancer. They're laying there in the bed with tubes running all out of them. Amen? No head. Some of them this big in the incubator. You know what I mean? I think I have a lot to be thankful for. And so because that when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God. Because our things become more God than our God is. Our stuff, what are you talking about? The way you feel becomes more than your God. What do you mean by the way I feel? If I don't feel right, if my nose is running on one side, I can't do nothing. If somebody, you know, doesn't feel like they're appreciated, they can't do nothing. If someone don't feel like they're exalted enough, they can't do nothing. Because their self-image becomes more God than God is. The thing they want to do is more. Listen, if you're not doing it for the glory of God, you're doing it for the wrong reason. If you're not doing it to promote Jesus and His kingdom, you're doing it for the wrong reason. If you're not trying to, lift up the kingdom of God, if you're just trying to, how did Brother Shaw say it whenever we were at that leaders meeting? If your star doesn't stop where Jesus is, and you are still the star instead of the Jesus, I know the star, then you're in the wrong place. Because you're not the star. He's the star. And so, when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God, neither were they thankful. Because we're not thankful enough for what God's done in our lives. We're not thankful for what God's doing in our lives. Can I share this with you? And please don't get upset with me. And please don't be angry at me. Don't slide my ugly note in my door because I'm not going to read it. I'll look and see what the first verse is and I'll throw it away. But hear me. We've got to determine this. Who are we going to be? What is this church going to be? We can go back the old way we were. If that's what you want, I'll see you. And I don't mean that as a threat or anything like that. I'm just telling you, I can't go back the way I came. Forward is the only gear I have. I can't reverse. I can't go backward. I can't backslide. I can't go back and do what we used to do. Listen, I've said this time after time after time again. The old temple of praise way, we got to get out of our spirit. Not all the teachings, not what we were taught, not everything like that. The way we treat each other has got to change.
Amen.
The way we treat the calling of God on our life has got to change. We're not thankful for God calling us. We act like it's our birthright because of our last name. Really? I don't care who you are. I got some stuff I'm going to have to deal with. And it's going to cause people to be mad at me. With big boy pants on. Okay. Why? Because we're not doing what God asks us to do. And so, as the leader, you have to take care of some stuff like that. Because, listen to me, get this in your spirit. Listen to me. I don't care who you are or how much I love you. I would choose to have God's blessing on this place than have you like me.
Amen.
You understand what I'm telling you?
Yes.
I would choose to lose you as to lose him. I don't want to lose you at all, and I don't ever want to lose anybody in the church. I don't ever, but listen to me. I would rather lose you in your sorry attitude than lose God in his glory. I don't want to lose that. And I can't, listen, I'm trying to dig a bigger hole than I can to get out of. Here we go. Because I choose to have him. And if it costs me every friend I've got, I choose to have him. I choose to have His glory in the house. I choose to have His passion in the house. I choose to have His will done in this place. I choose to advance the kingdom of God instead of advance your kingdom. I choose to do that instead of advance what I want to do, but what does He want to do? And I choose to do that because that when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful. I said this Wednesday, I believe, that we take it for granted that God has chosen us to open up the Word of God and teach it. Amen. And to preach it. And no matter what age group it is, it doesn't matter what age group that you're doing, we've got to teach the Word of God. We've got to teach it.
Amen.
Nursery. Teach them. Teach them something. Primaries, whatever. I don't even know the age groups anymore. Whatever. I haven't taught Sunday school class in so long. I don't know what they are. Juniors, teenagers, next step, whatever. Teach them something.
Yeah.
Teach them about the Word of God. To open up the Word of God and know this and be thankful that you're the one that God has set there right at this time to be the teacher.
Amen.
And to bless them.
Yeah.
And I said this Wednesday, and I'll say it again. I wish I could pour into you the passion I have for young people and for this church. I wish I could duplicate myself. I wish I could show you what it is to have your heart just so full of God that you want to share it with. Amen. This young lady right here was part of our youth group, and I hopefully she learned something. I don't know, but hopefully I did a decent job of pouring into her something. Daphne in the back, I did a decent job of pouring something into her that when we were doing that stuff, hopefully.
Yes.
Because the passion is to reach them.
Yes.
The passion is to pour something into them that they can't ever get out of them. That's the passion. But you can't get up there half-hearted, try to pinball around some little stumbling, mumbling junk and expect anybody to care what you're talking about when you don't care either.
That's right.
Amen.
The Lord said something. Don't nobody want to hear it.
Right.
Well, He did something with something and something happened. There's a hell out there. Y'all be careful. Yeah, and it just, you know what I'm saying? There's got to be some passion behind it. I think I said that Wednesday. Amen. But I'll go on. Romans 1:21 said, but neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations. Let me share something with you, please. In 2 Corinthians 10:5, we're talking about the image that you present. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ.
Amen.
What are we doing? We're casting down the image that we have and exalting the image that He has.
Amen.
The image. What is it that you think you're doing? But what is it that He called you to do? Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God. Go back to 1:21, please. You don't have to, but He's going to switch it on the screen. Dude, it's hot in here. Because that when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations. Go back, please. Casting down.
Yeah.
Imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. How many knew God? How many know God? So the thing casting down imaginations and everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. I'm going to get real deep. Can we get a little deep?
Yeah.
Or a leap? Whatever. Okay? Casting down every imagination and everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. You said you knew God. But what is that thing that exalts itself above God that keeps you from having the image of God would have you to be? The image. What is it that God wants you to do? What has God called you to do? Okay, I'm coming. I got 12 minutes. I'm coming. I'm thinking more than that. I got 12. The imagination or the image casting down the image and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. If I know God, and God has called me to be what? His servant. God has called me to be his son. God has called me to be a worker, a laborer with Christ. Is that what he's called me to be? And so the vision of this church is to reach the lost no matter what, right?
Yeah.
But I think we've gotten distracted from that vision, and now it's whatever I need to do and how I can position myself. Sorry. And so anyway, I don't know if you guys have noticed, but I'm getting a little weary of that. I don't know if you noticed that. Okay, and so understand me. That the image, what's an image?
Picture.
Thank you. Someone listening. A picture. What is going on in your brain? What is it that God's laid in your spirit? What is the picture that God has given you? What is the ministry that God's given you? What is it he's called you to do? What do you see when you remember? Listen, think back. Think back. Come on, think back. Think back. What is it that God called you to do? What is it he asked you to do? The image. Don't let the devil pervert the image. Don't let the devil come into your mind and transform. Well, I knew it wasn't going to happen this way. I'm going to go find me a Hagar and do it this way. And so the image, casting down the imagination of every high thing that exalts itself to the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Bringing forth captivity, come on. Bringing into captivity every what? Thought. Everything that comes to your mind that is contrary to the Word of God, get it under control. This is your mind. It's not the devil's mind to play with. This is your mind. Now, listen, you don't get anything done without a mind that works for God. You don't get anything. You have to have your mind right. You have to have your mind right. And bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. What's he called you for? What's the image that he gave you? What's the calling in your life? What is it that God's asked you to do? Get that image in your mind and don't let go of it. Don't let go of it. Go to the next one. 1 Chronicles 29 and 8. I'm sorry, 28 and 9. 1 Chronicles 28 and 9. 1 Chronicles 28 and 9. How many know where Chronicles is at? All right, so I'm almost done. Ready? 1 Chronicles. Thank you. And thou, Solomon, my son, know thou the God of thy father, and serve him with a perfect heart and with a willing heart. By it. For the Lord searcheth what?
All
hearts, and understands all of the... God is searching your heart. For the Lord searcheth all hearts and understands all the images of your thoughts. If thou seek him, he will be found of thee. But if thou forsake him, he will cast thee off forever. He's searching your heart. Why is he searching your heart? Because out of the heart comes what? Oh, come on, Bible scholars. The heart of a man comes what? Evil tree or good tree, right? Out of the heart, the abundance of thought, okay? Okay. So he's searching your heart, not what you do, not your mindset, not what you do when I'm around, but what you do when I'm not around. What do you do when God's called you? No, listen, what do you do when God's asked you to do something? Your heart, the thing inside of you, your spirit.
Amen.
What is it that you do? Are you doing what God's called you to do? And so God searches your heart. Why? Because out of the heart, the abundance of God, right? Okay, your evil tree or good tree out of your heart, right? But the Lord searches all hearts and understands all the images or imaginations of the thoughts. So what, are you guys, are y'all walking with me? Y'all with me? Okay. Y'all looking at me like I'm stupid. Okay. And understand the imaginations of the thoughts. If you seek him, he will be found. But if you forsake him, he'll cast you off forever. I'm just talking to Solomon. Can he talk to me to Solomon? Yes, he can. So, my son, know thou the God of thy father, and serve him with a perfect heart. Okay, you have a perfect heart. Does that mean you're going to do everything perfect? David was what? The man after? Did David do everything right? But what did David know how to do? Repent. Boy, y'all quiet up in here today. I don't know if I'm in the right place or not. I don't know if I'm preaching the right thing or not, but y'all quiet up in here today. Because if you serve God with a perfect heart, then we don't have to deal with stupid stuff. You see, I already lost something because they're already mad because I said it was stupid stuff. It's not, I know it's real, I understand that. Come on. I know that thou, God the Father, and serve him with a perfect heart and with a willing mind. Having a perfect heart means this, is I'm gonna get my thoughts under control. Christ and him alone. My thoughts under control. I'm gonna do it. Him and him alone. Whatever it is. I'm not gonna let the image of what I want, I'm not gonna let my vanity raise itself up above God. I'm gonna do what God asked me to do, and I'm gonna do it the best of my ability because I love him. I'll get over the hurt that you caused me, but I'm gonna love him and do what he's asked me to do. Amen. Know thou the God of thy Father and serve him with a perfect heart and with a willing mind, for the Lord searches the hearts and understands all the imaginations of the thoughts. What does that mean? He understands what you're going through. He understands what the image is that he's placed in you. He understands what he wants you to do. But here's the thing. He's got to search your heart and see if you've perverted what he's asked you to do. Have you perverted the image in your mind? God gives you a perfect image of what he wants done. And then we start tinkering with it. Because it doesn't happen like we in our mind thought it should happen. And so we begin to start tinkering with things in our lives. And then we get in trouble. And then we ask, God, why did you let this happen to me? Instead of taking the vision that God has given us, taking it what God has asked us to do, and running with it, what we do is we have this image in our heart, what we want to do, and not necessarily what God wants to do. And we have a pathway to get there that maybe it's not God's way. And then we wonder why things crater. It's because we're not following the image of God. And when God searches our heart, he finds this perverted thing, and he can't use that. He can't use that messed up image. Because he gave you what he wants done. Let it be done in earth as it is in heaven. And what God wants in heaven gets done like that. When God gets done on earth, he has to deal with us, and so it takes a little while. And so, understand what I'm telling you? Be thankful for the gift that God has given you. Be thankful for what God has asked you to do. Be a blessing to what God's asked you to do. Be thankful that God's called you. Boy, we don't so get that, do we? We think that that's just like an everyday event. That God's called us to do something is just like, big deal, God called me, big deal, I'll do whatever I want to. Really? Really? And then we get all excited, we jump the gun, and Hagar's looking pretty good, and so we'll have a Hagar baby, and have Ishmael, and God's like, I didn't call you to do that. I said you would do that. I told you to do this. This is the way I want it done. Can I share with you that God's not ever going to bless what you want to do? He's going to bless what he's asked you to do. See, we always want God to move. Oh, God move. Hallelujah. Yeah. God's already moving. We either choose to get in the river or not. I've gone over the Mississippi River many times. And I've yet to see it not moving. It's so big and deep that it doesn't look like it's moving unless you see something floating in it. But it's always flowing. God's the same way. He's so big, maybe you don't think he's moving. But that's because you haven't jumped off any. And you're screaming and hollering at the bank, oh God, move, oh, hallelujah. And God's like, what? I'm always moving. So I want you to be thankful. Number one, that you're saved. If you're in this place that you're saved, you ought to, man, we ought to come into this place with a smile on our face and a joy in our heart and something, I mean, God in heaven, I'm saved in the name of Jesus. Number two, the blessings that you enjoy. My goodness, when you woke up this morning, you were richer than most of the world by being in the United States of America. You're richer than most of the world by just waking up. We don't really see that, do we? I've only got three TVs. There's only four cars in my driveway. We only have like five cell phones. Oh, man. That 1% is killing us. That 1% people are killing us. Of course, 1%. Shut up. You have more stuff. I don't know who blessed us with this stuff right here by the back door of the church, but you need to take it back. I don't know where to put it. I don't know what to do with it. I don't know whose it is, what it is. I don't know who is it. If someone dropped off some stuff, from regardless, it looks like. I don't know who it was or what. We're lucky. I don't know what to do with it. But we have more stuff. You know, Ernie Lewis is getting rich by selling rental space for people to put their stuff. The Hardens are getting rich by having space to put stuff. Because our garages are full, our attics are full, our cellars are full, our sheds are full. We're going to have to get a rental. Really? How about getting rid of some stuff? Amen? But we're not really thankful for that. We're just kind of like, well, wish I had that. There's nothing wrong with having stuff. I'm not preaching against having stuff. Come on. I don't care. I want you to be the most blessed nation in the world. I want you to be the most blessed people in the world. I want you to have the nicest things in the world. I want you to be blessed. But be thankful for it. And not critical that you don't have the newest whatever. Now, iPhone 6, can't wait for the next one to come out so you can spend $600 on it at $23 a month. So you can be the first one to go, oh, is that the new iPhone? Yes. And in a month, it's in your pocket all scratched up. Amen? But hey, for that first week, yes, I'm listening to music on my iPhone. It's $600 on it. Not me, I just changed carriers. I got it for free. You don't get nothing for free. Don't let them lie to you. It's like folks that, please don't get mad at me, but it's like folks that go and refinance their cars because they go take it and trade it in. Yeah, the dealership paid us off. No, they didn't. It's stuck on the end of your payment and you're not paying for it. What is that? Now, you may have gotten out of it for right now. You're going to pay for it. They're not going to, God, listen, I hate to bust your bubble, but your car's got 4,000, you owe 10 on it. They're not going to eat $6,000 so they can sell your car and make $2,000. I don't know if you know that or not, but that just doesn't happen. Okay? And so, don't do that stuff. Okay? But be thankful for your stuff, okay? Number three, be thankful for your church. Be thankful that God has allowed you to be here. Be thankful that God has allowed you to be where God is moving and God is doing things in your life. Be thankful. Be thankful for the people that love you and care about you and are trying to do the very best they can to be a blessing to you. Listen, I know this for a fact. Not anybody in here that is trying to hurt you in any way, shape, or form. They're not. They didn't get up this morning and say, how can I hurt them? They did not. Now, did we do everything right? Not even close. But we're trying to do our very best to help. So be thankful for your church. Number four, be thankful that you're called. Be thankful that you're called to do the things of God. Be thankful that God has chosen you to open up the Word of God and to speak the Word of God to whatever group that you're speaking to. Be thankful for that. Be thankful that you're called to be a deacon or an elder of the church. Be thankful that you're called to play music. Be thankful that you're called to sing. Be thankful that you're called to teach children's church. Be thankful, whatever it is, be thankful for it. And don't look at it as a drudgery. And please don't misunderstand me. And don't say what I didn't say. This is what I'm going to tell you. If it's a drudgery to you, please tell me you don't want to do it anymore.
Yeah.
Because I don't want you to come here going, oh my goodness. Please, get that thought under control and get it under Jesus. Amen? Boy, it got quiet. Well, I'll tell you why. First thing I'm thankful for is what? Salvation. Second thing, stop. It's the blessings that God's given you. Listen, I'm going to share this story that Dean and I were sitting at a table yesterday, and Dean can probably tell it better than I can because he talked about it. But there's a lady there from Turkey. Her name is Sylvie. Sylvie Muhammad. And she was there, and long story short, her family cut her off and said, if you're going to turn your back on Muhammad, then let Jesus take care of you. And she has a business where she makes clothing, correct? She makes clothing. She doesn't advertise. She doesn't have her name in the phone book or all that. She has no web page. People come to her house and they say, I want this made. And she said, God has blessed me. I can write a $1 million check and not even worry about it. Yeah. Like, people are afraid. She got completely cut off from her family because she changed from a Muslim into a Christian, and they said, let Jesus take care of you, and he did.
Amen.
So why is it that if a Muslim can convert and be a Christian and God can take care of her, why do we as Christians feel like, oh God, whatever, what's wrong with you? We had a cool table today. There's some more stories I can tell you about some other people around the table. They're just really, really cool stories. And I'm thinking, why are we here? And so, I'm thinking, okay, offering. We're going to make our offering check. And so, how much do I have in the bank? I got to think real fast. How much do I have in the bank? And so, hear me. Be thankful. You serve the one and true and living God. They can do anything. It can take you anywhere. It can do anything for you. But we just sometimes forget to be thankful.
Amen.
To be thankful. I'm thankful for you. I am thankful for you. I'm thankful that you're my church fan. I'm thankful that, you know, that we're growing and we have things that go on and that just happens and hallelujah, praise the Lord. But I'd rather do that than sit around and go, well, yeah, Janet's been doing it for 14 years. She's still doing the work she did 14 years. I don't want to do that. Amen?
Amen.
I want to be growing and doing stuff. And please get with me and understand this. The growing pains happen, and you have to do things differently than you've always done it. I shared the ICE testimony Wednesday, and if you guys don't know the ICE testimony, you should have been here Wednesday. Amen? About the way we're talking about ICE, but we did it 4 different ways. Amen?
Yeah.
And so I'll share it with you some other time. Should have been here, please. Just help me. Understand this. And I'll get you out of here, I promise. I just want us to be thankful for what God's given us. If we come back tonight, we're talking about being confident. Be confident. I'll wait. Send your feelings.